So finally the rain is coming. It took a long time. Let's see if we can hammer away at belief some more, because that's what we need to do. All day long I've been standing up to this incredibly crazy bully of belief and just seeing, you know, how it, you know, keeps trying to scare us like a barking dog is trying to bite you. And you have to, you know, get away, shoo away, go, get out of here. And they have to kick it. Very important to do this right now, because belief is just unbelievable what it does. It's completely nuts, and yet it tells us that somehow we can somehow please it. All the while we're pleasing belief, what is it doing? It's trying to destroy us. It's trying to figure out a way to destroy us, and that's the secret. Belief says there's a mystery at the root of existence. Yes, there is. It's not a mystery though. It's something that belief doesn't want you to know about. And that is that it is trying to destroy you. It is trying to destroy reality. And you are reality. All reality is one. So you are reality. It's trying to destroy you. Meanwhile, it's having you jump through hoops and do all this stuff, you know, that is, and doesn't tell you what its real purpose is. Now, there's nothing in this world worth dying for. The world is not worth dying for. You need to look at each, vet the whole situation, say, is this worth dying for? No. Is this worth? No. Why does then belief say that, you know, this is, we should die for all of this? We're supposed to die for it. What's so important? It wants us to die. That's why. See, body minds are just a way of symbolizing reality. It wants us to identify with these body minds, and it wants these body minds to die. And of course, it's trying to find something to die for, so that we'll say, well, this is worth dying for. Yeah, let's die for this. It's wondering what is it that reality will die for? You know, have to find something that reality will say, okay, I'll die for this. I'm willing to die for this. There's nothing. This planet is not worth dying for. The whole universe is not worth dying for. These trees, you know, I was driving along today and there's all these beautiful trees and I thought, oh, you know, this is worth dying for. I said, no, wait a minute. Okay, let's look at this. This particular tree right here, what about this tree is worth dying for? Well, it's got the, you know, the trunk and some limb branches and some leaves. I say, a trunk, some branches and leaves, that's worth dying for? Come on. What about this one? So you take each one, you start to realize, whoa, wait a minute. It's not worth dying for. Now, of course, what we're getting is this light reflected off of that. So what we're really saying is something worth dying for. We're saying, is this light, reflective light, worth dying for? Okay. It is not. When we see anything, it's because light is bouncing off of it, and we're perceiving that reflected, refracted light. Is that worth dying for? That's the question. It's not, because there's another light. The true light is not a reflective light. It's not a refractive light. It's not the light coming out of suns through, what is it, fusion or something like that. It's not that light at all. And our senses are only designed to pick up reflective light, you know, from sunlight. And various kinds of light that is, you know, we can manufacture light from light bulbs, etc. But that type of light is not real light at all. And our senses can't see real light. They cannot see it. They don't even know it's there. So belief is trying to say, hey, this is worth dying for. You should come here to die. We come here to die. We come into this world to die. And nobody wants to admit that. I mean, I don't know how many people you've come across in the world say, well, yeah, the purpose I came into the world was to die. You know, say, oh, no, I came here to be a fireman or a doctor or conservationist or a social activist or a mother or, you know, whatever it could be. But someone says, no, I came into this world to learn how to die, because that's why we came here. And actually, we're not even here. We're identifying with bodies. When we say that we came into the world, meaning that means we are identifying with a body mind. We're not in the world at all. What we are is not in this world. It's not even in the universe. But it's identifying with some facet of the universe, and so it thinks it's in the universe. It's kind of like a puppet, you know. It's like a movie. If you identify with a character in the movie real strongly, you might think or believe you're in the movie, because everything that happens to that character you're identified with, here, you know, you say, oh, I hope that doesn't happen. Oh, I don't want them to die. And you know, you're reacting as if that character was you. Okay, and then you're experiencing all the stuff in the movie. No, you're not in the movie. You're watching the movie, not in the movie. So, the world and the leaders of the world, our great leaders, expect us to die for them. And this is a fact. I experienced this very clearly. What's happening now? 15 years ago. And those in power expect us to die for them. And I said, it was super intimidating. Like, I think it was the most intimidating dream I've ever had. And I thought I was going to die. I have to die for this leader. And I said, the last second, I said, no, you know what? No, you're not worth dying for. I'm not going to do it. And had to back away, like, whoa, what? What are you talking about? I said, no. Turn the tide. So, it's very important to get after this, because what's in motion right now are those who expect you to die for them. They expect it. They demand it, and they will put the ultimate pressure on you. Sanitation workers here, picking up the trash. All right. So somebody has to say no to that, you know? Say no. No. We're not going to die for you. Absolutely not. We're not going to die. There's not for anything. There's nothing worth dying for. Why? Because what we are cannot die. So it's futile. It's a waste of time. It is an exercise in insanity. Death is an exercise in insanity. That's all that it is. You cannot die. What you are is spirit. You're included in reality. Reality is all-inclusive. Everything, the total extension of reality is included in the totality of it. All of it, without exception, unconditionally. And there's nothing in reality that can die. Nothing that can be even threatened. So, what we are cannot die. So why are we saying that we're going to die for something? It's completely silly. Utter nonsense. What we mean is, we're willing to sacrifice this body-mind to attain some purpose. What is the purpose? Try and change reality is the purpose. We believe it will help further the goal of finding a way to change reality, finding a way to threaten reality so reality is forced to change. And that is futile too. So all this sacrifice of bodies is futile. But those who want to sacrifice their bodies, they need a leader. You know, they need those who will say, okay, folks, I am asking you now to die for me, for some, you know, die for America, die for the planet, die for the leader, die for something, you know, die for Mother Earth, something, right? Someone will come along and ask you to die for that, and then you'll say, oh, okay, since you asked, I guess I'll do that. So someone has to come along here and say, no, there's nothing in the world worth dying for, nothing in the universe worth dying for. There's no goal that's worth dying for, because death as a goal can never be reached. Nothing in reality can die. And reality is our home. So the question of something worth dying for is a ludicrous, meaningless question that we're asking ourselves. What is worth dying for? Nothing. We can't die. It's ludicrous on many accounts. Reality cannot be threatened. We cannot die. So on both those accounts, the goal is ludicrous, and the means to try and reach it are also ludicrous. But it is important to know that those in charge of the world now expect you to die for them. They have this sacrificial complex, is what I call it. You get these demagogues, and the demagogues are basically put in place by those who want to die. Okay, they come here for sacrifice. And the demagogue will lead them into the black hole of sacrifice. And the demagogue expects it of them, and they are just saying, well, I'm just following expectations of this great, great being. You know. So we stand up to that and say, this is utter nonsense. Now it's raining. Are you gonna hear that? Let's listen to it. And it doesn't matter who the leaders are, what their names are, because there always will be these demagogue leaders who, you know, leaders of the sacrifice, these high priests of sacrifice who come into the world and all their accolades, follow them into the world and say, we're here to submit to your will, you know, what tell us what to do, and they'll say, well, you need to die for this cause. You need to die for that cause, etc., etc. What cause does reality have is the question. Does it have any causes? Does it need to have some causes? What are the great social causes of reality? What is it that reality needs to change, fix? Anything? Anything at all? No, there's nothing. There's no reality doesn't have any causes. It's not seeking social justice. It's not trying to die for some sins. It's not, it doesn't have any sins. It doesn't have any injustice. It's perfectly fair. Perfect, unconditional love for all. Total inclusiveness. Total perfect freedom. Etc. Invulnerability. Etc. 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 So there's no causes. Reality doesn't have any causes. It's not asking anyone to die. Nothing can die. Nothing can be threatened. So we are simply engaged in nonsense in this world. And yet, we continue. Why? Because we believe it's a process. You know, you hear them say, what's important is the journey. Well, of course, because the goal can never be reached, what are you going to say? Except the journey is where it's at. What else can you say? Because you can't reach the goal. You cannot reach a goal threatening reality. All the sacrifice is futile. So you're going to say the journey is what's important. So, it's a futile journey to nowhere. You don't have to undertake it. We can say, at some point, we can say, no. We're not dying for you. We're not going to die for you. And I tell you, in that dream I had, the one that was demanding that I die was stunned. Absolutely stunned by my refusal. He just could not, you know, it was like completely shocked. So, they didn't die from the shock. They just were like, you know, like, what? Nobody can refuse me, you know. I said, well, guess what? Somebody just did. It's the first time for everything. So there needs to be a first time for everything. So we need to stand up to the bully of belief here, right now, and say, no, I'm not dying for you. That's ridiculous. And further this spirit, you know, saying, no, we're not dying. And belief will just say, well, okay, let me find something for you to die for. Maybe, you know, you know, maybe a beautiful woman, well, you'll die for that. And say, no, not doing that. And it'll keep looking. It'll keep saying, okay, maybe you'll die for this, or maybe you'll die for this. And we got to find something you're going to die for, right? I say, no. How about choosing a new idea? How about that? Then I don't have to die for anything. And belief being completely insane has no idea what you're talking about. And belief believes that you need to understand that your problem is lack of understanding, lack of compassion. You're not compassionate enough. See, if you don't die, agree to die for something, belief says you're lacking in compassion. You know, you're selfish. You're ignorant. You're whatever epithet I can throw at you, you know, you're that. And I say, no, belief, you're insane. Because you're serving an impossible purpose, a purpose that can never be realized. And you don't realize you're insane because you're saying it can be realized. So you got no, you know, you have no choice but to be insane, but that doesn't let you off the hook. I mean, that doesn't mean I'm going to go along with your insanity because you have no choice. You're just an effect arising from a cause. The problem is the cause. And that's where we have to change the situation at the level of cause. Whereas belief tells us we must deal with whatever we're dealing with has to be at the level of effects. Because obviously level of cause is level of reality, creation. And if we look at that level, we see you cannot change reality. Only by looking within effects can we believe it's plausible that we can accomplish the impossible. So belief says we must look in effects. And if we say no, then belief says, oh, you're too stupid. You can't do it. You're lazy. You know, what's the problem? No. Too smart to do that. Too smart to do that. And belief will just throw up its hands and say, you're incorrigible. You're incorrigible. You're terrible. Absolutely terrible. You can't be reached. You can't be reached. We'll have to find someone else to reach for you. Just wait a while. I'm sending somebody to you. I say, oh, really? Who's that? And belief will grab a hold of anyone it can that's really wise. Belief will say, okay, who can I send to this one to get them to start looking within effects for causation? I say, and then belief will say, well, I'm going to send Jesus back to you. He's going to come back and he's going to set you straight. And I say, well, good luck with that. And well, I'm going to send Ananda, my mom, back, and she'll come here and she'll set you straight. I say, good luck with that, because they know the truth. They know the truth, but, and so they won't bother me that way. But belief will say we're supposed to wait until it sends the guru your way. The guru for what? The guru to what? Convince you that you're supposed to find causation within effects? That's not a guru, that's a lunatic. So really belief is waiting for some lunatic, trying to find a lunatic that is persuasive enough to persuade us to die for nothing, to sacrifice ourselves in vain hopes that causation can be found in belief. And why should we keep waiting? You know, there is no lunatic that is right. Maybe there's some lunatics that are rather persuasive. There have been a few come down the road, for sure, who put on a big song and dance about their spiritual authority, you know. But they've already been vetted. And so belief tells us, just wait, I'll send someone to help you. Help me with what? Help you with what? What are we supposed to be helped? Helped for what? What do I need help for? To find causation within effects, to keep the search going? I don't want to do that. It's futile. So I need help to accomplish the impossible? There is no such help. I need help to continue traveling down a road of futility? Only the insane would see that as help. I need help to agree with the goals of insanity? Only insanity would see that as help. You see, so belief keeps telling us to wait. Wait, 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 I'm sending someone to you. So that is one of its greatest tricks, really. That's why we're wait, wait, wait. Because belief says, okay, 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 I can see you're a special case. You know, you're a very special case, it tells you. You know, it uses this the specialty thing. You're special, you're very special, it says. I say, really, why? I'm not special, what are you talking about? I'm just gravitating towards sanity. Nothing special about that. Just gravitating towards reality. Why is that special? Everybody will do that. And belief says, no, 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 no. You're very special. I mean, you're the most special, special person I've ever come across. And just because you're so special, I'm really going to send you the most incredible gift imaginable. I'm almost got it. Just wait a little bit. I say, huh? Why? What are you sending me? I say, well, wait a minute. I've been waiting, you know, my whole life. You've never sent me anything. And you say, and belief says, no, I didn't realize how special you were. I said, what do you mean you didn't realize? I've been this way my whole life. What are you talking about? It's taking you all this time to figure that out. And belief says, well, I couldn't believe anybody could be so special. It's taking me all this time. Ah, you know, really? Doesn't it? Something smells fishy here, you know. And belief says, no, I'm sending you someone who can deal with your specialness. Maybe he's waiting for some drug to be manufactured or something, you know. I said, well, you know, belief, I really cannot wait any longer. I got a feeling that you're trying to send a persuasive form of insanity to me to try and redirect my goals back to your goals, the goals of belief, which is the goals of sacrifice, the goals of attempting to find a way to destroy, threaten and destroy reality, all of which is impossible and futile and a waste, complete waste of time. So basically, you're wasting my time when you say wait. When belief says wait, it really says, let me waste your time a little longer. All right, let me waste your time a little longer. That's all it's saying. And it says, because I got something special for you. Well, yeah. What's it got for? Anyone's got death for us. So we're just, when the belief says, wait a little longer. I'm not sure how I got to find something for you to die for. Because really, death is something we have to agree to. We have to agree to it. That's why all death is suicide. It's because our death comes about because we agree to die. That is actually the truth. Now, in the case of someone like who's a perfectly awakened, like Anandamayi Ma, she said that her body was simply acting out the wishes of her devotees. They wanted her to die because that was that was their expectation. That's where they were at. So she said her body's, you know, died. And some of them came to her and said, hey, look, we know that you could rejuvenate your body in an instant. We've seen you do it before. Why don't you do it again? And she'd just say, no, the pull of the unmanifest is working. But within there, it was also the fact that the devotees, in this world, we expect bodies to die. We expect death to take place. Now, for her, it wasn't death at all, because she never identified with the body in the first place. So it's just this useless piece of rags, what she called it, was just would disintegrate now, because its usefulness, people said, okay, that's enough. But in our case, so that wasn't a suicide, but in our case, because we're identified with body minds, death is a suicide. It really is. We have to agree to it. And if we say no, it has to back away and look for some more attractive form, something that we'll agree to die for. So this is kind of like the inside scoop on belief, which is what I'm giving to the world here, having been in the halls of belief and thoroughly examining it and seeing what's really going on behind the scenes. And then now spilling the beans, because belief is completely insane. It says, how can you spill these beans? Because belief has no option but to be insane. It was born of an insane idea. So it's not like you can be compassionate to belief by agreeing with it. It doesn't help at all. Belief cannot change what it is. It believes it can, and it believes you can help it change. You cannot. You cannot help it change. Therefore, you must dismiss it. You must dismiss it. Beyond dismiss it, just choose a new idea. You must go to see where causation, where it is. And belief is trying to prevent that. It can't prevent it, but it can get you to agree to delay it. And that's what it tries to do. It keeps bringing in more and more attractive forms, just saying, what kind of attractive format do you need to agree to continue with this plan of sacrifice? And it's waiting for your answer too. It says, just let me know and I'll provide it for you. That's the situation we're in. It can be scary to see just how nuts it is. But at the same time, if you can handle seeing that, the first knee-jerk reaction, you might be, wow, this is too much. And then you can say, well, wait a minute, maybe it's not too much. Maybe there's something within me that's not intimidated by seeing the full scope of this. And there is something within all of us, the voice of reason, the voice of clarity, that which is the child of reality, is not intimidated by belief, is not frightened of seeing this stuff. It just says, yeah, great, you're finally seeing it. So we have to stand up to the bullies of belief. Now, those people in the world, those leaders of sacrifice, they're just extremely weak as far as being intimidated by belief. They've not yet developed the skills, that they've not yet listened within to the voice of sanity, reason, clarity. They haven't spent the time to do that. They've been too busy spending time trying to gain power, trying to gain position and power over others so that they can then decree and demand sacrifice from them. If they had spent their time listening within, they wouldn't be coveting worldly power the way they do, and control over others. They wouldn't be doing that, because the voice of reason would say, hey, don't waste your time. Don't waste your time. That's a waste of time. Don't do that. So the very fact that they are in such high positions of power means they have not been listening within. And so if you don't listen within, you feel that belief is like God, and you got no choice to do but what it tells you to do. And so you're a puppet of belief. And of course, belief demands sacrifice. It demands death of everything. So they go along with that agenda. And of course, they try to, you know, gild the cage a little bit, make themselves look good. But for those who have listened within, they're not fooled by that. You know, just say, ah, you're a quisling, you're a weakling. not judging them on the level of causation. Of course, we're all brothers, sisters in Christ, in reality, in truth, and spirit, in the one sonship. Of course, that. But practically speaking, there are those who have not yet recognized. They feel they've separated. They're no longer part of reality. So they're trying to make a separate reality. And the way to do that is they believe through sacrifice and demanding death of everything and everyone. So they act as these puppets of belief. And we just have to say, you know, thanks but no thanks to them, you know. You know, blessings upon you, but we're not going that direction. Don't have to, you know, insult them. No, you know, we got to go beyond insults at this time. The situation is more serious than insults should be dealing with. I know I look at the internet and, my gosh, you know, everybody's hurling insults at each other, you know. It's getting more and more serious, you know. We're talking about, you know, you need to be in a mental institution. You need to be on meds. You need, they're starting to get to the point now of labeling each other as insane and needing to be, you know, re-educated. Okay, well, that's where it's going, of course. As insults build up, eventually you get to the crux of the matter, which is belief says that those who rebut belief and refuse belief need to be re-educated, need to be on meds in a mental institution, a re-education institution, to redirect their goals in alignment with belief. That's where it's going. But hurling insults is a waste of time. The way to stand up to belief is deeper than insults, okay? So you don't hear me very often getting into any insults like that. When I say they're completely insane, it's just a factual statement. Belief is totally insane from the very beginning. That's not a judgment on belief. Belief is a child of an insane idea. That's on spirit. Spirit's responsible. I'm responsible. You're responsible. Spirit, level of causation, is responsible for choosing the idea of trying to be prime creator and then giving rise to this insane scenario, hypothetical scenario of belief and sacrifice. So spirit's responsible. Therefore, it's spirit that has to choose a new idea, not belief. Belief can't choose a new idea. Effects cannot choose to serve a different purpose. It's impossible. So, but spirit has the right to properly recognize the facts of the situation. And without being termed judgmental, you know, I have a right to say these leaders are patsies for belief. That is true. But I'm not judging them on the level of spirit. I know that one day they will awaken and see this fact as well, and they will be freed as well. No doubt about it, 100% guaranteed. So it's not like I'm cutting ties with them forever. No. Just the opposite. I'm affirming ties with them forever by choosing a new idea, seeing reality cannot be threatened. And that affirms that all aspects of spirit are one with my aspect of spirit forever. See? And so it's actually an affirmation of non-separation to reject separation. It really is. So, insults don't arise from this sort of use of language and concepts and clarifications. But if we don't use it, well, for sure we're going to slip down into insults. If you're an adamant person, if you're passionate, adamant, determined, you know, really want to be free, etc., and you don't look at it from the level of causation, voice of reason, voice of clarity, and bring your language and consideration and inquiry up to that level of use of language this way, you are going to get into insults. And this is going to get worse and worse and worse. And eventually insults lead to blows, right? And then blows lead to full-blown wars. You see people in the Middle East and in various places in the world who are so used to insults. I mean, it's incredible. Looking on the internet, I go to different countries and different forums from different countries to assess, you know, what kind of language are these people using? Where is the level of discourse? And good Lord, you know, it's like in the Middle East, they've honed insult to a fine art. It's the most vicious type of insult, and they hurl them back and forth like rockets at each other. And, you know, it's incredible. Whoa, they've really are taking insults, you know. They're very schooled in how to be extremely vicious with insults. Of course, if this is your discourse, level of discourse, it's super easy to translate that into actual armed conflict, bodily harm, conflict. Very easy. Whereas if you have a very civil discourse, civilization means that which is civil. It's based on civility. Okay, it's not based on hurling hostile insults at one another. That's not civilization. That can't give rise to a high civilization where we can feel like, hey, you know what, let's spend a lot of time in true inquiry. So, you know, there are still some areas where people are civil in this world to a certain extent, but the internet is just blasting all that down, tearing it all down. It seems to unleash the beast in people, and they begin to engage in insults. It gets worse and worse and worse. I mean, it's unbelievable. I've seen on forums where insults are allowed, and what happens is it gets worse and worse and worse until the whole forum just collapses. Really. So why do you think civilization won't collapse if the level of discourse is as low as it's going now and being torn down even more by popular culture? Okay, by everything we see, the movies, all the whole culture that we view, those are role models. Whether we admit it or not, they absolutely are. And of course, those who are doing this will say, oh no, you should know better than to, it's just entertainment, there's no role models there. Yeah. No, the way human beings are is they look for role models. They desire role models, they seek role models. And they will grab a hold of that which just seems glamorous and powerful and cool and sexy and whatever attraction, and use those as role models. So of course, those who produce all the popular culture in the world know exactly what they're doing, and they know exactly that they're producing role models for the world. They know it 100%. They're just lying about it when they say, no, we're not intending this to be role models. They're simply lying. Belief is lying about this. And so we see all these role models, you know, surround our environment, culture. And the level of discourse that they're using is lower and lower and lower and lower, you know. Then we these are our role models, and we pattern our behavior, our thoughts. Oh, this is expected. This is how to be cool. This is how to be sexy. This is how to get the glamorous, you know, girl or the glamorous guy, or how to get this beautiful home or power or whatever it is we want. This is how to get it. And we lower it down more and more and more. Closer and closer and closer to a state where conflict is easily engaged in, because we've demonized those to such an extent that we feel they're lower than the lowest possible thing. You know, they're completely worthless. They're just, you know, useless, using up oxygen, useless. And this stuff is now, you know, just nobody even pays any attention. It just shrugs like, yeah, that's just the way things are. That's normal. No, it's not normal. It's a planned result of 50 years or, you know, or more of a very determined program, like a 50-year program to lower the level of discourse and civility in the world, so the world can easily be pushed into all-out conflict, a world war. It's been done on purpose. I've seen the whole thing take place, and I've seen how people very determined, baby step, and when you call them on it, they get extremely upset and angry, because their goal is sacrifice, planetary suicide. That's been their goal. And those who have been fighting against that, which is to try and bring in civility, haven't been listened to enough, because, you know, that those whose purpose was to lower everything down, they are very clever at using the glamour. Okay, the glamour of the whole situation, and glamorizing the path of lowering discourse down into collapsed civilization. And they made it look sexy, you know. They made it look very sexy and attractive. And, you know, those who want to raise the level of discourse, you know, they seem kind of old, you know, we're all old-fashioned, boring. It's not boring at all. The most wonderful people I've ever met in the world had extremely high levels of discourse, and it's like unbelievably witty and wonderful. You're just like, wow, this is super entertaining, very funny and vibrant, and you can feel like it's scintillating, you know, and leading somewhere that is beautiful, wonderful. This hurling of insults, where does that lead? It leads to blows, you know. Now, people say the afterlife. Well, we'll escape this all in the afterlife. Imagine if there's some bully is like choking you to death, got his hand on your neck, you know, and squeezing the breath, life out of you, and you're gasping for air, and you say, at the last second, the bully releases, you know, and you go, you know, and you try to get some air, and you say, I finally got some air, and then the bully, pull once again, starts choking you, you know. Imagine a bully who just did that over and over and over and over and over. That's existence. The afterlife is just a bully loosening its grip on you a little bit so you can get a little bit of air oxygenation in, and so then it can tighten its grip again. Another birth, start tightening its grip again. That's all existence is. There's this bully strangling you over and over again and releasing its hold just enough so you can catch your breath a little bit, and then so it can do it some more. Because it enjoys this process, you see. It doesn't enjoy it. It's simply compulsively engaged in this process of sacrifice. So what you need to do is punch the bully in the face, as it were, and push the bully off of you and say, hey, no more. No mas. That's it. Finished. Finito. And the bully will say, oh, no. Just wait till the afterlife, and there, everything will be fine. No, that's just like a brief vacation, gasping for air. You get a little bit of air, and then back it goes. Another birth, another exercise of the bully strangling the life out of you. That's what it is all about. That's what existence is all about. And of course, the bully will also say, belief will say, it'll tell you that it knows how what will please you, what will satisfy, how you can be happy. You say, belief, I'm so unhappy and miserable. And belief will say, don't worry. I know what makes you happy. And you're, really? Oh, yeah, of course. Belief says, I know everything about you. I know what makes you happy. And you say, what? Belief will say, music. Music will make you happy. And you say, oh, really? And belief say, yeah. And you say, well, I'm not happy yet. And belief says, well, listen to this. And you say, well, that's kind of nice. And listen to this, and listen to this, and listen to all this music, and say, well, I'm still not happy. And believe will say, yeah, okay, but I'm just getting you ready for some even better music, and that'll make you happy. And I've got all these great musicians working night and day, and they're going to, a new song is coming. I remember when I was young that I literally lived, the only thing I was living for was the next songs that were coming out for my favorite, you know, artists and bands. And when we found out that an album had just been released, back then we had albums, vinyl, had just been released by like our favorite bands, it was like, we said, oh my God, I'm finally going to be happy. All this terror of existence, which is trauma, finally, if I just listen to this, it's going to vanish for me. We literally believed that. A lot of people, not everyone was into music that much, but there were a lot of us. And I was super, super that way. And I couldn't wait, you know, to get down after school, and you had to buy, and before that was 45s or singles. You had to get that single from Elvis or however it was. And you felt, and you listened to it. I listened to it nonstop, all night. My parents say, go to bed. And I know I got to listen to it for the 100th time. In the morning, listen to some more. Come back from school, listen to more. And when they came out. When they came out with albums, then we had a whole album, like, you know, 10 tracks or something. I was like, unbelievable. I'd listened to it all year. You know, I said, because belief said, this will make you happy. It will banish all, everything that you're complaining about will banish it. So I became, you know, this extreme aficionado of music. I was previously in my previous life, too. I produced a lot because belief said, hey, I said, look, people are dying. The trauma here is horrible. I said, this is horrible. And I had friends and stuff who suffered horrible fates, just beyond, you know, terrible stuff from illnesses and various things. And I said, what can I do, you know, to help the world and bring happiness to the world? And belief says, well, you can produce great music. And that's the answer. And so I said, okay, I'll do whatever it takes. So I worked my whole life in producing great music. And I came back to this world now, and I realized the trauma is still here. And I said, what's happened? You know, I thought you said that by producing all this great music, it'd bring happiness in the world. And in between, you know, in the afterlife, and I came back and I realized there's all these world wars, and this terrible stuff happened. I was shocked. I really was stunned by every stuff, all the trauma that happened since I left the world previously. And I said, Belief, what's going on? And I thought my music would prevent that from happening. People would be happy. And Belief says, well, you know, you need to produce even better music. I said, wow, I thought I worked my entire life on that, dedicated, and it wasn't good enough. And Belief says, it was almost. See that? And so Belief says, you almost did it, but just a little better. And now look at all the different modalities of music. Electronic music is here now. And if you use electronic music, it'll succeed. I said, wow, really? Okay. And I gradually got talked into it. And so then I started up again trying to produce, you know, the best music in the world somehow, using, you know, the electrified instruments and blending those with other, you know, non-electrified instruments, and just trying to, you know, produce a new, you know, soundtrack to existence that would make people happy. But the problem was that all my efforts led nowhere. And Belief says, you're going to be, all the money will come, all of everything you need for to be really famous and effective, and money and everything will come. I didn't get a single dime out of the whole thing. I spent massive amounts of money, went into terrible debt, never got a penny from it, never a penny. And then Belief said, well, you need to learn how to sing, because that's a missing element. So I spent all this years and years and years trying to become the best singer possible. Never got a penny out of that either. Never went anywhere. And so I began saying, wait, you know, within I was saying, wait a minute. There's something doesn't add up here. It just feels like, you know, there's something that this is all some kind of very clever ruse. And so underneath everything, I was observing and examining everything that's going on in the world, and just being aware, more and more aware, more and more aware, and saying, you know, just looking at everything, not sure exactly, you know, how it all come together, but saying there's something needs to come together, something needs to, I need to see something more clearly, because there is something that doesn't add up here. And so eventually, I've gotten to the point now where I'm able to see, you know, the big picture more, much more clearly, and, you know, out Belief for what it's doing. Belief says that music is, will make us happy. That's all we need. But that keeps Belief, okay? We can, the Belief says we can maintain Belief as if Belief was our God, but still be happy as long as we have the right music, or if you want to extend it, the right entertainment. Or if you want to extend that, the right partner or partners and the right drugs and the right home and the right parties and the right friend, all this stuff, okay, and entertainment, all that. He says, if you just have it all set up right, which it was trying to do, it tried to engage me in this huge project to set up this massive global party. Okay, I was writing the soundtrack for this massive global party that was supposed to take place. And there's supposed to be these great leaders of this massive global party that were going to get everybody involved in this. And never happened. Never happened. So basically, I was completely scammed by Belief and by attractive forms of Belief. Belief approaches you in many different guises, but whatever is attractive enough for you to go along and say, okay. All of this designed to prevent one thing, which is from you choosing a new idea, from me choosing a new idea, and dropping Belief altogether. It was designed to prevent me to stand up to Belief and say, no, you know, you're insane, you're completely insane, and you're wrong, you're deluded. And the remedies that you're applying are not remedies at all. We don't need, music won't make us happy. Freedom will make us happy. Freedom from Belief will make us happy. Okay, because all of reality is a song. It's a song. It's a beyond any song we could ever imagine. Okay, it's everything. It's everything we want it to be already. And we need the freedom to experience that. You see, we need the freedom from Belief. Only freedom from Belief will make us happy. And Belief says, no. You don't need freedom from Belief. You just need some great music. And it'll tell you, or, you know, it, whatever is your weak spot, you know. But, of course, we tend, many in the world tend to find the greatest happiness in the world from music. And I've been that way for sure. Is, you know, for me, there's nothing that seems to elevate, you know, me more than music. But the fact is, music does not elevate you to the level of discourse that we're having right here. It does not. It does not. I had to do that in a different way than music. Not at all. Music falls short of that. It falls short of standing up to the bully of belief, because it's belief itself that is promoting all music and all this. To soothe us enough so we don't see the rawness of existence for what it really is and recognize the insanity of it and the insanity of belief. You know, it says, hey, just listen, spin a record, just listen, go on YouTube, click on this video, and just listen, how great is this? I say, yeah, it's pretty great, and it spins around your head, and you forget about looking how terrible belief really is, how it's, what its purpose is to destroy us. So as we're listening to this beautiful music, belief is going full on to figure out a way to destroy us, full on. And before you know it, there's just some, you know, power broker of belief who's there saying, guess what, folks, I'm telling you it's time for you to die for me or die for your country or die for some ideology, you know, die for the goddess, die for the mother goddess or something like that. If you don't die for the god, then belief pulls out the goddess on you, you know. So you can, you know, we vetted God pretty well, you know, the god of belief. In other words, belief believes it's God. We vetted that pretty well and say, no, God, we're not dying for you anymore, that fake god. And then belief says, hey, no problem. That wasn't it in the first place. I was only preparing you for something that really is worth dying for, which is what? Ah, the goddess, of course. The goddess is here. And belief says, now there's something we're dying for, the goddess. Wow, look at that. And so we've been caught kind of blindsided by the goddess. The return of the goddess, as it were. It's been a while since the goddess has been around. The goddess of belief has been around. So we got blindsided by it. And I was pretty unique in that I had suffered under the hands of the goddess previously so severely that I was very, very skeptical of the goddess, you see. She used and abused me severely. So I had some, what do you call it, immunity to the goddess. I've been immunized through terrible sufferings and travails in the past lives. And so when I said, no, wait a minute. I'm not going along with the goddess, you know. And so that's very unique. There's, you know, most people have been, you know, blindsided and hypnotized by the goddess of belief. It's just belief trotting out another marketing device, you know. And when the marketing device of the god doesn't work, then the marketing device of the goddess is employed. And most are kind of like attracted by that, you know, like, wow. So I severely vetted the goddess, which is why I can speak out this way. You know, I went through the whole thing of diminishing the attractiveness of the goddess. I've been through that. I was extremely focused on that, because I know that the goddess is going to be used to demand sacrifice of everyone on this planet. And, you know, when the god, you know, when the patriarchy says, everybody, okay, it's time to all fall down, ashes, ashes, we all fall down, time to sacrifice, we say, no, God, we're not so sure about that, we're not going to go along. And then the patriarch will say, oh, but we're just serving the interests of what's really in charge, the matriarchy, the goddess. That's the one who really wants us to sacrifice, and we'll say, oh, I see. Okay, I guess it's okay then. We can't disobey the goddess, you know. Well, I sure can. I can sure disobey the goddess, because I realize it's just belief. You know, it's just belief masquerading in an attractive masquerade, in a glamorous masquerade, using, you know, maternity and sexiness and attractiveness, power of attraction and motherhood, all, you know, and all this stuff, the feminine intuition, feminine this, feminine that, blah, 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 on and on and on. Saying that the goddess said, the purpose of men is to worship and adore the goddess and serve the goddess, you know. Well, of course they're saying that, because it's, belief is saying, marketing it that way, because belief is expecting us to obey the goddess and go along with sacrifice. It's absolutely expecting that. But here, you don't get that. Here you say, I don't bow to the god of the belief in the form of God. I don't bow to belief in the form of the goddess. Belief is completely insane. It's nothing but a homicidal maniac. That's all that it is. It wants to destroy reality. and just using these props of these stick figure props of flesh, you know, to so-called accomplish this. And so we're accomplices in this, you know, we're viewing accomplices. As we're viewing this, we're nodding and saying to belief, yeah, it looks like you got something here, you know, because we want to be prime creator spirit. So we're looking at belief saying, wow, belief, you certainly are clever, And, oh, here comes the goddess on the screen. We turn down the god of sacrifice, but here comes the goddess of sacrifice now, and we're all swooning. It's like, holy cow, she's a knockout, you know. She's a real knockout. Yeah, well, she's not knocking me out. That is for sure. And she doesn't have to knock you out either. All right? You can stand up to that. But we say, oh, you know, all the laws have been changed. So we're getting to the point now where standing up to the goddess of sacrifice is going to be a criminal offense. Seriously. I've been acutely aware of this because I know how it all works. And they're desperately trying to criminalize standing up to the goddess of sacrifice. Okay? To say no, we're not doing it. That's a criminal, super criminal offense. Now, that is the goal of all this legal changes that have been taking place for you know, frantically, you know, demonizing any attitude to stand up to say no to the goddess of sacrifice. And of course, they're trying to encode it in the legal system, and they're very clever, step by step. You know, they'll call it a hate crime or something. You say no to the goddess of sacrifice will be like the worst crime you can possibly commit. So we're all terrified we're going to be imprisoned. You know, if we say just say no. If we say, you know, it's okay to say the emperor has no clothes. The emperor of sacrifice has no clothes. But it's not okay to say the empress of sacrifice has no clothes. That will be dealt with severely, you know, harsh repercussions. Yeah. So you have those in power right now who are willing and able to force these changes in laws, have the judges in place, and, you know, all the whole legal system align with that. You know, they tried to label it like misogynistic or something. You're anti-female if you stand up to the goddess of sacrifice or some nonsense like that. Which is, you know, it's lumping all females together as if all females want to demand sacrifice, you know, which is nonsense. It's not true. There's been a lot of females in the past who stood up to the bully of belief, whether male or female. They said, no way. And there's a lot in the world right now who are standing up to the goddess of sacrifice and saying, no way, you know, no way. But they are being called traitors, you know, traitors to the great cause of the sisterhoods. You know, the sisterhoods are traitors to feminism, or they want to regress and put females under the power, the cruel power of the patriarchy. You know, all this propaganda, you know, what they're really saying is, belief is saying they're traitors to belief. You no longer want to continue on submitting yourself to the demands of belief and sacrifice. And you want to turn away from that towards Christ, towards reality, towards spirit, towards truth, towards choosing a new idea, towards the voice of clarity, the voice of reason. And, they're deeming you as traitors to the cause. Brainwashed. The patriarchy must have brainwashed you or something. Which is just a severe insult to those women. Severe insult. As if they don't have the voice of reason within them. That's what belief is saying. It's like you have the voice of reason. You can't follow the voice of the clarity within you. You must be just being brainwashed by a patriarchy. Otherwise, certainly you'd go along with what the goddess of sacrifice is demanding of you. See? Which is just a severe insult to all those females, those women who are following the voice of clarity, the voice of reason, the voice of truth, and don't want this sacrificial plan anymore. It's saying that they don't have a mind of their own. They're incapable of that. That's what it's really saying. Okay, so who's misogynistic? Who is demeaning females? Really, it's belief that's doing it. It's belief, that belief insisting you must follow the goddess of sacrifice. Or if you're not, you're somehow, you know, it's too weak-willed, you're under the spell of patriarchy or something. Those are the ones who are truly insulting the intelligence of women. As if they're incapable of listening to the voice of clarity and standing up to the bully of belief. In whatever guise it comes in, whatever form it comes in. Doesn't matter whether it's wearing trousers or a skirt. It doesn't matter. Okay, at all. But now what happens is that, you know, when we stand up the goddess of belief, then what they do is they make the goddess of belief a lesbian and say, oh, you're saying no because you're homophobic or something. You know, so you have a lesbian goddess of sacrifice, and you're saying, oh, you're a hate crime because you're saying no because you're a homophobe, and you're not going along with it. And then they add another layer. They say, make it a black lesbian goddess of sacrifice, okay? And then you're saying no because you're a homophobic, racist, misogynist, okay? That is what they're doing. It's naked. It's completely obvious. It's blatant. It's been blatant for a long time. Totally blatant. And, you know, they'll probably have this black lesbian goddess of sacrifice with some animal there, and she'd probably be crippled, you know, crippled too, and just say, well, you know, you're against animals, and you're against handicapped people, and you know, on and on and on and on and on, right? Whatever they can do to make you feel guilty to stand up to this bully of belief, this insane sacrificial plan of belief, they will do it. And it's comical. It is really comical, to tell you the truth. It's so blatant. It is so ridiculous. It is so comical. And it's so insulting of our intelligence, you know. And yet they don't care. They continue to insult our intelligence day after day after day, exponentially insulting our intelligence, as if standing up to them means somehow we're you know, totally terrible people, and that somehow we're incapable of listening to the voice of reason. We must be brainwashed not to do this. No, we're not brainwashed. We're very clear about truth, about sanity, about reality, because we've listened to the Holy Spirit. We listen to the voice of reason, the voice of clarity, the Christ within us. Okay. The truth within us, the reality within us. We've listened to that. And guess what? We're not so stupid as you want us to be. So, we're not just going to march like lemmings to your tune. Okay, I don't care. We don't care if there's a crippled, black, lesbian, animal-loving goddess of sacrifice telling us it's time to march to this tune of sacrifice. We're still going to say no. You know, no, no, and no. What don't you understand about no? Huh? What don't you understand about no? No, no. No means no. Right? No means no. What is it about no you don't understand? Right? That's what we should be saying, right? What is it about no that they don't understand? It's because belief is insane and doesn't understand anything about reality. Right? And you can't argue with insanity. It just keeps thinking that you're too stupid to understand it. Which is not true. Right? So you need some of those in the world who are adamant. And I'm trying to be more and more adamant on your behalf. Because belief is completely insane. Ananda Maimah was super adamant. She'd just go quiet. When belief tried to run its shtick on her, she'd just sit there and go into samadhi, go into quiet. And like her consciousness would like go into this such a high state, you know, of withdrawal, that it would like people would just like stop talking and say, well, hold, what happened? Is she dying? She almost seemed like she's going to this like, you know, the super conscious state, or whatever you want to call it, some nirvikalpa samadhi. She was always in it, but she withdraw her communication. She'd withdraw from the communication device, which is the body. Just a communication device. That's all the body is, a communication device. Nothing other than that. The will to communicate through this device would be withdrawn because there was no will asking for it. No one was asking for it. When people be running the shtick of belief on her, the willingness to communicate would be withdrawn, and the body would become icy cold, like it was dead. I turned into a statue. The people touch it was icy cold. And it was completely unmoving, like it was utterly dead or beyond something other condition, and they would then freak out and say, oh my gosh, why do we bring her back, this, you know, and they'd do all this singing and chanting and prayers, and they'd reorient themselves to stand up to belief, and then it would gradually, the communication device would be reactivated. What happened when she deactivated the communication device? And then it would be reactivated when people drop this silliness about belief. Well, that's very adamant, you know. Yeah, scared the heck out of people. I'm not there yet, you know. I don't do that. But she did, absolutely. That's something else, you know, I'm telling you. That demands that you don't try to run beliefs, you know, try to run beliefs program there and say, hey, you know, don't ask her to be a goddess of sacrifice for you, because then she'll just deactivate the communication device. So we need those who are super adamant right now. I pray that there's someone more, way more adamant than me, like that, like an Anamaya Ma, who deactivate the communication device if we're not willing to ask, you know, to be helped in the right way. But even so, we can't sit around waiting for that. We still have to be as adamant as possible right now to say, what part of no do you not understand? All right? There are no parts to no. We're just saying, no, we're not going along with your sacrifice. Period. End of sentence. There is nothing more to it. A one-word sentence. No. That's it. So we need those voices in the communication devices need to be giving this adamancy, if that's a word, in the world right now. Because the belief is being very adamant in its demands. You know, and it's working on to trap you into this net of a legal net where you feel that your legal status is being compromised because you're saying no to the wrong people. You see, you're not supposed to say no to those people, because it will be inferred that your no is from some bigotry, okay? Some homophobic, racist, misogynistic bigotry. It'll be inferred, or you're just brainwashed by that, you know. They say to women, well, we know you can't be racist and misogynistic and homophobic, bigot, but you've just been brainwashed by those who are, as if they're incapable of seeing through the charade of belief on their own, right? That is a very insulting message that they're really delivering to women of the world. Very insulting, really. If I was a female, I would be very insulted by it. I would take great umbrage at that, at what the scam they're running on you. You know, most definitely. As a man, it's slightly different, because they're just, you know, directly, you know, insisting, you know, that men are wicked, you know, evil, wicked, selfish, non-compassionate, you know, horrible, terrible people, you know. And I know, I vetted it myself, and I realized that's not true. It's not true. They're lying about that. Because I'm part of the sonship, which is created by God, the Prime Creator, which is flawless, which is perfect. So I know belief is absolutely lying about that. So we need this adamancy. I gotta find a better word than adamancy. We need this adamant witnessing in the world right now to stand up to these bullies, because they're super, super, super bullyings are getting very nasty. Very nasty. And they're feeling their oats. They're feeling their oats now, you know. They're demanding equal results in society, right? Any disparity in society must be due to racism. Equal results must be there. Doesn't matter if you've got people who are superstitiously addicted to belief, or who are craven fools for belief. And they're supposed to get equal results to those who have spent all their efforts to clarify and be aligned towards truth and reality and sanity. So the insane are supposed to get equal results to those who are sane. If not the sane, are responsible for, are at fault, are guilty. They're at fault for that. How do you know? What kind of insanity is that to claim that the sane are the reasons why the insane are not getting the results that the sane are getting? That's what is being pushed now in this world. That those who are sane are maliciously causing those who are more engaged with insanity. Let's put it: those who are engaged with sanity are somehow to blame for those who are more engaged with insanity for the fact that they're not getting equal results, and that those who are more engaged with sanity somehow have to make it equal, all equal here, or else they're legally responsible with fines and imprisonment, etc., etc. That is where we're at now. We're already there. So You talk about bullying. You talk about bullying. That's what, you know, hey, hello. Hello, hello, hello. Connect the dots. It's basically saying that sanity has to lower itself into insanity. How else can you make it equal? Right? You can't get equal results from insanity. So in order to get equal results, you have to lower yourself down into insanity. So you'll get the same results as the others who are down there in insanity. That is literally what was being said now from the highest levels of politics and of power and legal systems, etc., is that the insane are supposed to lower themselves down to the level of the insane, relatively speaking, of course, which those who are sane would know that I'm speaking relatively because we're not absolutely sane yet. We're gravitating that direction, and those who are insane are not absolutely insane. They're gravitating, trying to become totally insane. The demand is those who are engaged with relative sanity have to lower themselves down to those who are insane, so equal results are guaranteed. That is what is being pushed now. And you wonder if elections have consequences. Absolutely, they do. They do. And people, at some point, they'll say, oh, you tricked me. You really, really tricked me. Well, you know, I have to say that the trickeration was completely obvious and blatant the entire time. Okay? It's just that, you know, you wanted to believe in belief a little while longer, you know, which is understandable. You know, from the standpoint of sanity, it's very understandable. Because of our habituation for so long that we have a hard time breaking that habit. We want to trust in belief. We really want to trust. And you get someone that's pushing belief very strongly, you want to trust them. You say, oh, this is better. Before I didn't trust the leaders, but now here's someone who's really adamant about belief. So you got to trust belief, and I'm going to push it. And we say, oh, okay, maybe you'll succeed. So you give them carte blanche, give them a blank check. And then what you find out, they're pushing equal results. Meaning you're supposed to lower yourself down to where the lowest common denominator, where the results they're getting, which aren't very good at all, you're supposed to be getting those same results. Otherwise, you must be extremely wicked entity. And then they throw the whole gamut of insults at you, you know. And you say, wow, I didn't realize it was going to be that bad. Yeah, well, yeah, it is. And worse. Worse than that. But, you know, that's about, that's pretty bad. That's about as bad as it gets, is demanding you lower you re-engage with insanity. That's what belief is after anyway. So that's scraping the bottom of the barrel right there pretty good. The other one is supposed to be, our purpose in existence is to worship the goddess. You know, that's been out for quite some time. That there are those who have been working on that angle too. And these angles will come together, supposed to equal results and supposed to worship a goddess. It's like a pincer action, you know. It's like a war pincer action on subtle levels. There's been a war going on the subtle levels for quite some time. Belief has been engaged in this massive war. And we've been in a state of war for, you know, I don't know, 100 years. I mean, you could say 400 years, but the intensity lasts 50 years, 55 years or so. Intense warfare. And they have this pincer action now, which is, one is we've been conditioned to, a purpose in life is to worship the goddess, especially for men. And for women, their purpose is to be the courtiers of the goddess, or to themselves learn how to be like goddesses, you know, goddesses of belief, of goddesses of sacrifice. You know, courtiers, really they're courtesans is what they're being taught to be, is being courtesans, really. And the men are supposed to worship the goddess and obey the goddess, and, you know, because that's our purpose. We're told that's our purpose in life. That's been going on for quite some time. So that the end result, that is coming in one direction. The other direction is supposed to get equal results of the lowest people, of those who are most engaged in insanity. They're supposed to be getting equal results to everyone else, even though those who are most highly engaged with sanity. They're supposed to be getting equal results to those who are most engaged within insanity, which is belief. You're supposed to have equal results and worship the goddess and do what she tells us to do. When you worship the goddess, of course, you're going to do what she tells you to do. That's the whole point. And she'll tell you sacrifice is what you need. Everybody needs to fall down. The whole planet needs to fall down. And of course, she says that will result in a much greater planet, much better situation. Heaven, you know, eternal happiness will be your result for just following her demands, goddess's demands, you see. So if you're wondering, like, hey, you know, maybe you've been your whole life been living, you think, I'll never hear anybody stand up to this. I know it's wrong. I know it's terrible. I know we're being lied to, deceived, conned. This whole thing is a ruse. But you say, you know what? No one's ever going to stand up to it. It's never going to happen. Well, maybe right now you're saying, huh, maybe not. Maybe not. I have reason to not engage with that belief, you know, anymore. Maybe it is possible. Maybe it is possible, you know. Hopefully you're feeling that way, you know, because I'm here to do that. And again, I wish I could do it a lot better. I wish I could get to the level of Ananda Mahima, but, you know, I kind of doubt that I could do that, really, because that level was perfect, where she could completely deactivate her communication device, freak everybody out, and boy, oh boy, oh boy. You talk about a tough guru there, you know. Wow. Scared the heck out of him. But I like to, you know, get more and more adamant. More and more adamant. And the adamancy, you know, is not insults. You can see. It's just higher level of discourse. It's just outing belief more adamantly, more clearly, more decisively. And saying no. Just simply saying no. No means no. It doesn't mean no, except if the goddess asks me. No, it doesn't mean that. It means no to any guise of belief. Any and every guise of belief possible, it means no. Bury it forever. It means no, not just for a certain amount of time. It means no forever. All times, all circumstances, all places, no to belief. No, no, and no to all of that. Forever, okay? That's what it means. So, you know, hopefully you realize it is possible. It is possible to stand up to belief, the bully of belief, even when it's engaging all this chicanery right now, which is legal chicanery. It is chicanery on every level, you know, trying to herd us into sacrifice by insisting if we don't go, we're racist, we're homophobic, we're bigots, we're misogynists, you know, and whatever thing they can hurl at us, we're you must be a one percenter, you know, they'll hurl that at you, or, you know, whatever it takes, you know, you must be this wicked prodigal son, you know, and we're bringing you back in the fold. You know, the goddess of sacrifice is pretending to be the good shepherd, but now it's the good shepherdess who's supposedly bringing us back into the fold. All us prodigal sons, so wayward, you know, we've been lost wandering in the mists of clarity, you know, for so long, and now she's bringing us back into the fold of confusion and sacrifice and despair and darkness and belief. And we're supposed to be so grateful. Because why? She's so beautiful or something? I don't know. I don't see anything beautiful about where she's bringing us. That's for sure. So how beautiful can she really be? You know, must be some kind of very thin veneer. Very thin veneer indeed. And if you listen to the high levels of discourse, you say, hey, this is more beautiful than the goddess of sacrifice. You know, the goddess of sacrifice, beauty is just superficial. When you start, you know, how come she cannot raise the level of discourse up to this height, you know? How come it's not really scintillating? How come you don't feel as if you're being elevated, truly elevated, and you feel freedom, the breeze of freedom, you're not feeling it? How come? Yeah, because it's just belief. It's just belief. It's just an attractive, glamorous form of belief that is doing this, you see? Okay, well, there we go. I actually did this taping at a time when I didn't feel exhausted, which is why I was able to bring the juice, you know, bring the juice. I said, I can't just keep waiting, you know, until late in the day when I'm, you know, collapsed. No, let's do this now, you know, let's get after it. And so there you go. How much? Wow, over an hour. A little pep talk here. Hopefully you're saying, hey, you know what? All is not lost. Maybe I can say no. and just say it and mean it. Yeah, you don't have to hurl insults or attack or do all this stuff. You don't have to come to blows. You can just say no. You just say no. Just say no. No chance. Not now, not ever. That's it. All right, that's it for this video. Very great.